Yes, you can start now. Okay.
It's okay.
Okay, it's okay.
Tell me.
Now life is starts. Yes, life starts.
I can start.
Yes.
Okay. So I Mingaraba. Good morning, everybody. So the topic for today is about spine injuries in children. Concerning epidemiology, this represents 2 to 3% of all pediatric fractures. And when we compare to adult injury, it's very few because for spinal injury, only 5%, it represents only 5% in children and 95% in adults. You have to know, very important, that it arrives often in polytraumatism in more than 35% of cases. So you have to do a very big examination to examine all the parts of the body. Concerning the localization, it arrives at the cervical spine in 20% of cases and 40% in thoracic and 40% in lumbar. And in 10% of cases, you can have neurologic complications. So you have to do immediately a very good neurologic examination for the child. In our country, I don't know if it's the same in Burma, but in our country, the causes of trauma is in 44% due to a fall from height or from a building. In 39% due to a sport accident, and in 15% due to a traffic accident. And after we have other etiology. And what is very important to know is that you have, according to age, the child has different activities, and also, of course, the child have growth structure. So you will have different types of lesions depending on age of the child. Another very important point is that anatomy point is that you have in child ossification centers joined by synchondrosis, and these ossification centers and the synchondrosis are maybe mistaken for fracture. For example, here you have the atlas with synchondrosis here. This is not a fracture, and at the posterior arch also, this is not a fracture, it's only the synchondrosis. Here you have the axis with the ossification center. You have four ossification centers with the synchondrosis. This is not visible on X-ray, but it's not a fracture. And for the other vertebra, you have the neurocentral synchondrosis. This is not also a fracture. You have to remember that when you see the X-ray. Now we start with cervical spine injuries. Just a little word about biomechanics. You have to know that below 8 years old, the cervical spine is more elastic. This is due to multiple factors. First, you have more horizontal facet joints, like you can see here in the young child, and after when with growth, the horizontal facet, the facet become vertical. And also another factor is that the soft tissue, you have a soft tissue laxity. Also in the young child, you have a weakness of the knuckle muscles and an anterior wedging of vertebral bodies. So the spine in below 8 years old is more elastic. And when you see below 8 years old, when you see an X-ray of the cervical spine, you can see some normal findings. You have pseudo subluxation of C2, C3. This is not abnormal. It's normal below 8 years old. Also, you see the wedging of the vertebral body, and you see there, that there is no or mild lordosis. So, but this is a normal X-ray in the child. Another point is that the child has a large and heavy head compared to the body. So in the young, the maximum movement before 5 years old is located at the C2-C3 junction. But in adolescents, the maximum movement is located at the C5-C6 then as in the adult. So that explains that in young children, you have more frequently injuries between C0 and C2, and in older children, you will have injuries of the lower cervical spine, like in adults. Because the child has a large and heavy head compared to the body, when you put him in a supine position, you will have a kyphosis at the cervical area. So this can worsen a neuro deficit. So when you receive the child, you have to put a blanket or to elevate the torso to have a good lordosis at the cervical spine. If you put only like that, you will have the kyphosis, so it's dangerous for the medulla and for neurologic deficit. So what to do in an emergency procedure? First, never use traction in case of an unconscious patient. You have to stabilize the neck with a cervical collar. And after that, you ask about the mechanism of the injury, and you do a complete examination of the child from head to toe. And also, you have to do important neurologic examination. This is important to see if there is a neurodeficit or not. And after, if you look at the X-ray, if you have the chance to do an X-ray, you have to remember some rules. First rules is that the distance between the anterior arch of C1 and the odontoid process is less than 6 millimeters or less than 5 centimeters. Very important, 5 millimeters. Also, you have to check to see the Schwechuk line. This line is very important. It is tangential to the posterior arch of C1 and C3, and this line must be tangential also to the posterior arch of C2. If this line is good, if these points are aligned, there is no problem. For example, here, in that case, you have a normal X-ray with a pseudo subluxation of C2, C3. But if you look at the Schwechuk line, this is normal with a well alignment. But in this fracture, the bipedicular fracture of C2, you can see the Schwechuk line is not normal. So there is a problem. So these two points are very important to know. When you look at the lower part, you have to check the alignment of the anterior and posterior vertebral body, which need to be very well aligned, and also the alignment of the spinal process. You have to check all that. Also, below C3, the spinous process spaces must be similar with the adjacent spaces. For example, here in that case, you have an abnormal wide space. So you can say that this is a high risk of instability, and there is a problem. You have to treat this problem here. So check the space between the spinous process. So now, if we see some pathologic cases, first, the atlanto-occipital dislocation. Fortunately, it's rare. It arrives in young children, and it is associated very often with an head injury, and it is often fatal. This is due, in that case, you have ligamentous injuries, so you need to treat with a posterior arthrodesis, and you can do with, like this example with Y, or with a bone graft and with a collar or halo jacket. But this condition is rare. Also, another rare condition, you can have a fracture of the atlas of the ring of C1. And when you see this kind of fracture, usually you need to apply the Minerva for 3 months. And after 3 months, you can obtain frequently a good healing, like in that case. If we move to C2, fracture of the odontoid process can occur. It's not rare in young children, and usually the fracture crosses the cartilaginous syngrodis, and you have an anterior displacement. Fortunately, at this level, the vertebral canal is very wide, and you have a space for the medulla. So you can have a very important anterior displacement without neurologic lesion because of the wide canal here. And the treatment is usually a reduction under sedation or under general anesthesia. And then you apply plaster of Paris, so Minerva, and you can obtain very often a good union. And only in case of non-union after the orthopedic treatment, you need to do posterior arthrodesis. Here you can see that case of fracture of odontoid process, and you can see after the reduction, and we follow the child, and 5 years after, you can see a good union, and with a good stability in flexion and extension. So the treatment is mainly orthopedic treatment. Also, you can have a bipedicular fracture of C2. It's called also the Hangman fracture. And in that case, also, the main treatment is an orthopedic treatment with a Minerva or a halo jacket for at least 3 months, and you can obtain a good fusion. In case of non-union or instability, you can perform a posterior fusion, but it is rare. Usually, you obtain the fusion by orthopedic treatment. And sometimes if you need to put a halo jacket, like in this example, because it's a young child, the bone is soft, so you have to put a lot of pins, and you see where to put the pins, the good area at the front, and at the back here. Never put in this lateral area on the temporal bone. Another problem can be an atlanto-axial rotatory subluxation. This can be due to traumatic causes, but there are also other causes like infectious disease, but mainly it's due to traumatic causes. And you have in that case a patient with torticolis. There is a classification by Fielding and Hawkins. You have four types. The first type is only torticolis with a rotation, but without subluxation of the facet, and you can reduce it very easily. There is no problem. The second case, you have torticolis with subluxation of one facet from axis and atlas. This case need to apply traction, and very rare condition are subluxation of the facet, but also with a rupture of the transverse ligament. And in that case, you can have a neurologic compromise. And finally, you have the fourth type. It's a posterior subluxation. It's very rare and often you have a neurologic compromise. So how to do the diagnosis? You can have an open mouth X-ray. And if you look at the open mouth X-ray, you can see an asymmetry between the lateral masses of the atlas compared with the odontoid process here. There is an asymmetry, so that means that there is a rotation and with a subluxation. If you can, you can do a CT evaluation, but no need to have the diagnostic and to treat the patient. So in that case, usually we apply traction with a cervical collar here. The traction is applied during 1, 2, 3 to 4 days. And usually if you do it in emergency, you will have a good reduction. For example, this case of a young girl with the torticoli here, and you can see on the CT scan, it's a type 2 of Fielding and Hawkins with a subluxation of the facet in that case here. So we applied traction, and after 4 days, we obtained a good reduction with a good alignment of the lateral mass of compared to the odontoid process. So after, we put Minerva or like that, and for 1 month, and after we obtain usually a good healing and everything is okay. But sometimes the diagnosis is delayed, and if you see the patient, for example, 1 month or 2 months after the trauma, it's very difficult to reduce with traction. We try to reduce with an allo traction, but often it's difficult and we don't succeed to reduce. So in that case, if we can obtain a good alignment of the neck and of the head, we let like that. And if we can't obtain a good alignment, in that case, we do a posterior fusion C1, C2. To align, but this condition is rare. But remember that it's very difficult to obtain a reduction when you see the patient after one or two months, because all is fixed. Now, concerning fracture of the lower part of the cervical spine, they are more frequent in older children. They are mainly due to sports injury or motor vehicle accident. And you can have all the lesions identical to the adult patients. You can have posterior ligaments injuries, wedge compression fractures, burst fractures, facet and fractures and facet dislocation and fracture dislocations. The treatment can be orthopedic or surgery. It depends on the type of injury, the neurologic status, and the degree of instability, but the indication are like in adult patients. For example, a case here of an instability with this subluxation here, and we choose to treat it by an anterior approach and with a bone graft, and we obtain a good results. Remember that the problem in children can be a multiple level lesions. I show you an example here of a subluxation between C2 and C3. We decide to treat the patient with a posterior approach and a posterior arthrolysis with this instrumentation with good alignment, but we see there is some problem with a mild kyphosis at the level here under the instrumentation. So, and what we can see after, you have a destabilization because there was a problem we didn't diagnose this problem at the emergency time, and we have the problem arrive after with this dislocation. So we need to do another surgery with an anterior plate to reduce the problem. So remember, you have to check the patient, and very often you can have lesions at multiple levels that you cannot see on the X-ray. Now we move to thoracic and lumbar fractures. Some word about biomechanics. You have to know that the child's disc has a higher water content and is a better shock absorber than the adult. So you can have multiple compression fractures. It's very frequent in child and more frequent than in the adult spine due to this biomechanics considerations. Of course, there are a lot of classifications. Some are very difficult to remember, but one is very simple and I think is a good classification. It's a Denis classification in three colon. I think you know this classification well. You have the anterior colon, anterior part of the vertebral body, the middle colon composed of the spinal cord, pedicle, posterior vertebral body, and the third colon is the posterior elements. If you have a problem only at the level of one colon, it's a stable lesion. If it's more than one colon, the lesion can be considered to be unstable and need an active treatment. So what kind of problem you can have in the thoracic and lumbar area in children? First is very often a compression fracture. It is due to flexion, and the flexion can be anterior or anterolateral. So it's Denis one type with only problem at the level of the anterior colon. And very often you can have multiple fracture. You can diagnose this on the X-ray, but sometimes on the X-ray, you can see only at one or two levels the compression. Of course, this is a stable lesion, but if we do an MRI in that case, we can see that there are problems with hyper signal at multiple levels. So this is due to the biomechanic conditions of the spine in children. So you have a multiple fracture compression here. But, of course, in the children, because of growth, you can have a good remodeling of the fracture, of the compression. And look at this example. There is a compression with here a loss of the height at the anterior part, but we treat it only with cast immobilization. And you look after 1 year follow-up, we have a good remodeling and the spine is now, it's normal. This is a good, of course, the chance for the child. So concerning treatment of compression in children, usually if the deformation is less than 10 degrees, we do a functional treatment, only a physiotherapy or an orthopedic treatment with a brace. If the height is more than 10 degrees to 20 degrees, we apply a cast, we do an orthopedic treatment. And in case of deformation, up more than 30 degrees. In that case, it depends. We can do an orthopedic treatment or surgical treatment. It depends of the pubertal status of the child. And usually less than research two, we do an orthopedic treatment. And after research two, it depends. We can consider a surgical treatment, but it's usually it's very rare. Very often we apply the reduction and we apply a plaster of Paris cast. Now, the second type is more rare, but it can occur with the chance fracture. The chance fracture was described a long time ago, It's an horizontal fracture that crosses all the vertebra. So it starts at the anterior part, vertebral body, and go to the posterior part. It's that horizontal fracture. It's called also a flexion distraction fracture or a seatbelt fracture because the cause is due usually to the seatbelts malpositioned and it's a fixed point here. So when you have a crash, an accident, it's a fixed point and the child go like that. So you have a flexion at the anterior part and a distraction at the posterior part. And you have this horizontal fracture, which is very unstable fracture. And of course, you have associated lesion. And in that case of chance fracture, you have an abdominal lesions in more than 50% of cases. And you have you can have a dramatic examination with a problem, abdominal problem. And if you take count only of the abdominal problem because it's an emergency, maybe you can misdiagnose the vertebral fracture. So in chance fracture, you have a very important risk of delay diagnosis. So remember that if you have some hematoma at the anterior part, that means that there was a fixed point here, you have always to check the spine and to do an X-ray and to do a neurologic examination. It's very important to diagnose very early the problem at the spine area. And of course, it's an unstable lesion. And in that case, you can have a neurologic compromise in 10 to 30% of cases. So very important to remember that not only to concentrate on the abdominal area, but also to check systematically the spine. In adults, you have a lot of classification because the fracture can go can cross the body, only the bone, but also the fracture can cross the ligamentous and the disc. And in that case, you cannot see the lesion on the X-ray because only you can see the displacement, but there is no osseous problem. But in children, it's very different because in children, you know that you have the growth plate that is located at the upper and lower part of the vertebra. And this growth plate is more fragile than the disc. So if there is a lesion, the lesion go across this growth plate area, but don't cross the disc. And if we look, if you do an MRI in a child with a chance fracture, we can see, of course, the classic chance fracture which cross the body, the bone, but sometimes the fracture cross the growth plate here, but you see in that case the disc is intact and the fracture cross here, but it can not be visible on the X-ray. So there are three types in children of this chance fracture. The first type is you see when you see this X-ray, you can imagine that there is a lesion here, ligamentous injury in the interspinal process, and that the lesion cross and go through the disc. But in fact, no, the lesion, this is the MRI of this patient, the lesion cross the end plate and the disc is intact. So this is the type one at the superior part of the body. Type two is a classic chance fracture, which cross the bone, the posterior part, spinous process, and also pedicle, and it cross the vertebral body. This is the classic. And the third type, the fracture, is here you can see the kyphosis without any lesion on the bone. But if you do an MRI, you can see that it cross the end place also, but the disc is intact. This is important to remember, because in every case you can apply a conservative treatment if you can, and you can have good results. It was reported in the literature. For example, this child had a chain fracture. We look at the X-ray, we cannot see bone problem, but because we did an MRI, and because we know that the disc is intact and the fracture goes through the end plate, we did a reduction under general anesthesia. You see the reduction, and after that we applied a cast, because we know that this lesion is a bony lesion and that can heal very well. And so we do that, we apply it under fluoroscopy, we apply the cast, and after we obtain a good consolidation and a good result without surgery. But of course, because in more than 50% of cases you have abdominal lesions that need to be surveyed, you need to be operated, you cannot apply the cast, and in that cases, of course, you need to perform a surgery with a posterior fixation, like in that case, only you see with spedical screws, and we obtain also a good result. So if you have to check to survey abdominal lesion, you do the posterior surgery. If not, you can apply a cast. And the third lesion is the burst fracture. It took you usually in older children. It's like in adults. And you have to check if it's a stable or an unstable fracture. To be stable, you need to have all these criteria. Normal examination, neurologic examination, posterior colon intact, a kyphosis less than 25 degrees, and the height loss less than 50% of the body. If you have one of these criteria, it's an unstable lesion. For example, if you have neurologic sign, a lesion of the posterior colon, height loss of more than 50%, kyphosis more than 35 degrees, or canal diameter inferior to 50%. And in that case, you need to have a reduction and a surgical treatment. So because it's a child, usually we prefer to perform, if it's possible, an orthopedic treatment, like in that case, in this burst fracture, it was a stable fracture, but we choose to do a reduction of that case under Cottrell frame. You see that case, we put a plaster of Paris, and we can see a good result after 4 years old with a remodeling, complete remodeling. We can do this type of treatment in children. But when it is an unstable lesion, or when there is a neurologic compromise, of course, you need to perform a posterior surgery, an posterior fusion. And first of all, you do a posterior surgery to reduce and to fuse. And after some weeks, you check if there is a problem at the anterior part with a very open space. In that case, you need to, after weeks, to do an anterior graft to avoid the recurrence of the disease with kyphosis. But first of all, you do it in an emergency, a posterior fusion, and after you check. Another condition, it is rare, but you have to know that in the child, is the apophyseal ring fracture. It is rare, it occurs in adolescents, mainly in boys, and it is due to a flexion rotation trauma. Of course, in France, we see that with a child who perform a rugby or gymnastic. And it's not only the disc, but it's a fracture of the listel, of the apophyseal ring, that can go at the posterior area, and you have a symptomatology like a lombosciatica with a compression of the roots. The fragments can be of different types, only a cartilaginous fragment like that, but also you can have a cartilage disc and a part of the body, which is a more a bigger fragment, and also depend on the location, it can be at the center of the canal or laterally. So the problem is that it's very often difficult to see on the X-ray, because if it is only cartilaginous, or sometimes you can see just a little piece of bone inside the canal, and in that case you can suspect fracture of the ring. And if we perform, you see in that case an MRI, you can see the fracture of the ring and it goes into the canal. So the problem is the treatment, because it's difficult. It's not like only a disc problem, disc degenerescence in adult, but this fragment is very strong and difficult to remove. So if you want to do a surgery, you have to perform a laminectomy, a very important surgery, and sometimes it's not necessary. So what we do in that cases, of course, if there is a neurologic deficit or very lombosciatica, very painful, in emergency we can do the surgery, but if we see the fragment later, the diagnosis is late, usually we control that, and we wait, and if it's not okay, after we do the laminectomy and the big surgery. But in emergency, you can do the treatment, but if the diagnosis is late, you can wait and see. Another condition you have to know is a SIWORA. That means it's a spinal cord injury without radiologic abnormality. So this is due to the elasticity of the spinal colon, because in infants, the spinal canal can elongate 2 inches before failure, but the infant spinal cord can only be stretched 0.25 inch before rupturing. So that means that you can have a neurologic compromise without any sign in the X-ray or in the scanner. And this occurs in young children before 8 years old, and you have a spine injury with a neurologic deficit, and the deficit may be immediate or delayed. That means that if you see the patient in emergency, after, the deficit can worsen in hours. So, and you, if you do the normal, the standard X-ray, it's normal, you cannot see nothing, and in that case you can have the diagnosis of SIWORA. And of course now we can see the lesion because we do an MRI, and the MRI can show the spinal cord is change, and you can also see ligamentous or disc end plate injuries. What you have to know is that in that case of SIWORA, the prognosis is very poor, and you have to do nothing. It's an unstable lesion, but so you have to put a collar to do orthopedic treatment for up to 3 months, but the surgery has a limited role in these patients. Only you have to wait and to see what happened, but it's a very bad condition. Finally, we conclude with the problem of child abuse that can have a very often injury at the spine area. It occurs in young children, and you can have a delayed acquisition with the child with a stiff spine and spine and the kyphosis, and you can see various types of lesion in that case in the young child, like compression fracture, subluxation in that case, and multiple lesions at multiple level in the thoracico-lumbar area. Also, you can have neurocentral synchondrosis fracture with a posterior displacement, like in that case, or an anterior displacement, like in that case. It's not a so rare condition, and unfortunately. So to conclude for this topic, you have to remember that fortunately, these spinal injury are rare in children. The type of injury depends on the age of the child, and it can be difficult to diagnose due to the ossification status of the spine in the young child. Remember that neurologic injury may be present despite normal X-rays, and in that case, of course, I know that you cannot have MRI, but if you can, you do an MRI. And remember that most of the cases can be managed without surgery, with orthopedic reduction and Minerva and cast with plaster of Paris. It's very important to know. So thank you very much. And if you have any question, I can answer. Thank you. How to do to.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you so much, Jerome. Sorry, keep you waiting. And then this morning, sorry about that. I mean,
I understand that you have a lot of meetings. It's not a problem for me. Don't. It's okay.
Sorry about that. And then next time, it won't be like that.